Hello, Krishna sir.
Yes, you can just
Okay,
continue.
yeah, we
Yes.
can formally start the program. And
Okay.
good afternoon, everyone. And today is we have a distinguished speaker, Professor Govind Krishnaswamy from Chennai Mathematical Institute. And we are also fortunate to have his lecture and students. So you're fortunate. So we have the series of so very fantastic lectures. And quantum mechanics and theoretical physics. First, we had the talk by Professor Devanand sir, and we also had the talk on nonlinear dynamics professor by Professor M. Lakshman sir, and we also have a wonderful talk on quantum mechanics by Professor Balki sir. And in this series, we have Professor Govind Krishnaswamy sir there. And before going Professor Krishnaswamy sir there, he will say some few words about the great mathematician, Professor Seshadri sir, and I'll present his slide and first, and then he will talk about Professor Seshadri sir. Yeah, I will present my slide here. Yes, okay. Yes, sir. Okay, yeah, please say a few words about Professor Seshadri, the great mathematician. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Professor Senthil Selvan, and good afternoon to all of you. I hope you are able to hear me. And thank you for the very kind introduction and the invitation. We are glad to be joined also by Professor Lakshmanan from Tiruchi. So, as suggested by, and please interrupt me in case you are not able to hear me or there is some noise or any other problem. We would like to fix it before going further or even in the middle. I do not mind the interruptions. So, as suggested by Professor Senthil Selvan, we can say a few words about Professor Seshadri. So, I work at Chennai Mathematical Institute, CMI in Chennai. This was started by Professor Seshadri around 1989 or so as a place for research as well as teaching of mathematics, physics, computer science, statistics related areas. Professor Seshadri passed away 13 days ago. Today was his 13th day after he passed away. So that is the reason I had to postpone my lecture from morning to afternoon because I had to go there. I must describe him first as a person, as a very, very broad-minded and visionary scientist of our country, like many others. And he is the reason I am a scientist here at Chennai in CMI. He was born in 1932. And he was born on the 29th of February. So that means he has a birthday only once in 4 years because it is 29th of February. Every leap year only he has a birthday. He was 88 this year before he passed away. He's a great mathematician. He started his career, I mean, he went to school in Kanchipuram. And in Chengalpattu, Kanchipuram. And then after that, he went to Loyola College in Chennai. And then he moved to the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai as one of the first batches over there after independence when the institute was set up. He soon became a very reputed mathematician. He proved an important conjecture of Sayre in when he went to France just as he finished his PhD. He, along with many other students, principally Professor M.S. Narasimhan, they set up a school of mathematics in TIFR, Mumbai. They showed what is possible just with a few books and contacts with people sitting and reading things by themselves and solving problems. Some of the problems they solved, they did not even know they are a big conjecture. They just took it as a problem and worked on it and found a solution. So, from rather humble beginnings as a schoolboy in Kanchipuram, he became one of the top mathematicians in the country and across the world. His area of expertise is algebraic geometry. In addition to that, he has also been a great inspiration to other scientists in India, myself included. And I must say that he has been very broad-minded in the way he has supported other areas and disciplines, not just in mathematics, also in physics and computer science, also in music. He was a great admirer and as well as exponent or a singer of Carnatic music. Just this morning, I heard one recording of his along with his wife. And he was, after leaving TIFR in Mumbai in the early 1980s, he moved to Chennai. He came to the Institute for Mathematical Sciences, IMSC Chennai Tharamani, was there for a few years, and then he started Chennai Mathematical Institute also here, along with help from the SPIC Science Foundation. Among the many accolades he got was the Fellow of the Royal Society of the United Kingdom, as well as Padma Bhushan from the Indian government. He was elected to various other the national academies and so on. And he was a very humble person and really empowered those around him. It's something that I really admire about him. And till his very last days, he was always full of ideas and coming and suggesting, why not do this or try that? He would come even to my office when I'm talking to other students, come and make some suggestions, not all of which I have been able to fulfill. His suggestions are very long-term suggestions. And he suddenly passed away of a cardiac arrest 13 days ago at home, at his son's home. And we are I feel very bad. I meant to contact him and speak to him the last 1 month. And for one reason or other, I put it off. Okay, there is some lockdown. Let me wait. And now I cannot even contact him. There are things I want to thank him for. There are things I want to ask him. There are things I want to tell him about. But now I cannot even do that. So this is a lesson to all of us. When there is a time to do it, you should do it, because that time may go away. In any case, I could go on about Professor Seshadri. I must really emphasize just how broad-minded he has been in encouraging people from very different branches of mathematics. Though he is a very focused mathematician, he both appreciated and understood and encouraged people in other areas. And that is something I really admire about him. So with those words, I think I'll send this back to Professor Senthil Selvan. If he has any more he would like me to say or what he has planned, please let me know.
Okay, Professor Govind Krishna Swami. We could feel the sad demise of Professor Seshadri sir, and he's well known mathematician and our country, especially algebraic geometry. And of course, yesterday I just browsed about his information. Then only I got almost all these kind of information. We lost for a great mathematician in our country, and he founded the Chennai Mathematical Institute. And you are the right person to say about these good words, Professor Seshadri sir. So he founded the Chennai Mathematical Institute and showed the light path actually to all the mathematicians, so that you are here in Chennai Mathematics, and absolutely you like youngsters will lead the mathematics and quantum and the theoretical physics in our country. So we wish you to go ahead in his line. And with these words, and I wanted to introduce about our distinguished speaker. Just a moment. Yeah, I want to share the screen. Stop the presentation. And now, I want to introduce.
Yes.
Okay. Now, I welcome Professor Dr. Govind Krishna Swami sir. And behalf of the Academy of Sciences Chennai and Department of Nuclear Physics and University of Madras, It's a wonderful opportunity for all you students of STIP Summer Training Program in Physics. And today we'll be delivering the talk on, say, free particle in quantum physics. I already contacted him, and I wanted to put and Professor M. Lakshman sir and Krishnaswamy sir all in the first few days, but he's so busy, and I couldn't able to catch him. So we are so fortunate again. He gave some concern to give a talk on this particular, say, summer training program in physics. And regarding his education CV's concern, when you look at these CV youngsters, please see that, say, he has a Bachelor of Science in Physics and Bachelor of Arts in Mathematics from University of Rochester, University in USA. And I find one word actually is summa cum laude. That means, I just understood that. Say, that means a graduate with the highest distinction in this Bachelor of Science and Bachelor of Arts in Mathematics. It seems to be a dual degree program. And he went on to study the Master of Arts in Physics, and then he completed PhD in Theoretical Physics in 2004 in University of Rochester in USA. And after completing his PhD, he acquired his postdoctoral research position, that is by means of, say, Marie Curie Postdoctoral Fellow in Theoretical Physics in Spinoza Institute, Institute for Theoretical Physics from Utrecht University in Netherlands. And then he pursued this postdoctoral fellowship actually from European, say, Research Council, that is EPSRC Fellow in Theoretical Physics, and he went from his postdoctoral fellowship from, say, Department of Mathematical Sciences and Center for Particle Theory in Durham University in UK. And after acquiring his postdoctoral research positions in Netherlands and the UK, and see, joined here in Chennai Mathematical Institute. And so that, because of his involvement in Chennai Mathematical Institute, youngsters all have the wonderful opportunity to hear these lectures. And he has got so many awards and mathematics and core research grants from SERB, from Government of India recently in 2019. And we look at these particular sites, he has so many say fellowships, say Raman fellowships, and in 2010 to 2015, an EPSRC fellowship awarded by UK Research Council in 2007 to 2010, and also the Marie Curie fellowship awarded by European Union, and say Susumu Okubo Prize for Master's Degree Studies in University of Rochester. And then for his graduate study in same university of University of Rochester, he won the Sproul Fellowship, and he also awarded the Epcar Award from American Physical Society in 1999. Then he won the Best Senior Thesis in Physics in University of Rochester and Stoddard Prize. And he also won the Arthur Gale Prize for Best Graduating Senior in Mathematics. With all his actually good education in some mathematics and physics, and he got almost all these awards, and that made him to work in our Chennai Mathematical Institute. And his research interest are in, so, quantum field theory, matrix models, fluid and plasma dynamics, nonlinear dynamics, integrable systems. And you see that he loved actually to teach various theoretical physics subjects like nonlinear dynamics, thermal physics, quantum field theory, continuum mechanics, applied complex variables, group theory and physics, particle physics, classical mechanics, quantum mechanics, and computational projects, mathematical physics. So he has so we have a very wonderful, say, the speaker now. And so let me again thank Professor Govind Krishnaswamy sir for accepting our kind request to deliver his talk. Now I am requesting Professor Govind Krishnaswamy sir to deliver his talk on quantum mechanics. Thank you, sir. Now you can share your screen. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Sendil Selvan. Okay. So you have given a very detailed and kind introduction. I feel a little bit embarrassed. Thank you so much. Yeah. So please do tell me if any noise or something, because there is some construction nearby and they make a lot of noise. In case it's a problem, please tell me. I will shut the windows. So let me then mention that today I plan to talk about a rather limited, my goal is very limited today. It is to describe some basic aspects of quantum mechanics of perhaps one of the simplest systems, namely a free particle. So I have in mind the free particle in quantum mechanics. So I'm grateful to the summer training program in physics for inviting me to talk at this in this series. This is my second time speaking in this series. A few years back I had spoken, and that was very different because we could actually go to Madras University and stand in near the board and use the chalk. Now I feel very different. I think, perhaps you have all become used to this mode of presentation. I am still getting used to it. So are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Very good. Is the font visible and so on? Okay.
Letters are visible. And let me ask student. Okay, please. Students, can you able to see the slides?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
Can you go ahead?
Okay. And can you hear me also clearly?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, sir.
Yes, thank you. So I can hear many students saying yes and so on. So that is very nice to hear. I would like to hear also more from you when we go on. You can please, if I ask some question, you can offer answers. You can yourself ask questions also, so that I know where you are following, or if you have some clarifications you would like to seek. So it is really very nice that both the government of Tamil Nadu as well as Department of Nuclear Physics, Madras University, is taking the effort to organize this program every year. And I think you, the 64 or so of you, perhaps more, are very lucky also, I hope, to attend this program. So let me get started then. And please feel free to interrupt. And ask any question if it's not clear or you want additional details. So what we will do is to consider a particle that is free to move in one dimension on the real line. Yeah, on the real line, particle is free to move on the real line, one particle. So there are no forces acting on the particle. So no forces, that's why we call it a free particle. And therefore, the potential that describes this system, V of x, is simply zero. So that x is the coordinate along the horizontal line on which the particle is free to move. I know this is the very last lecture of a two-week program, so you may be tired. I will try to make it not too demanding. And I am not very familiar with your background, so I'm going to start with basics and explain things as clearly as possible. So the Hamiltonian operator, Hamiltonian that describes this system, is simply a kinetic energy because there is no potential at all. There is no potential energy. So the kinetic energy in this case is given by p squared by 2m, where p is the linear momentum. Now, the dynamics of the system is described by the Schrodinger equation, which I think you may have encountered before. We will first begin with the so-called time-independent Schrodinger equation, This is an equation for the wave function, wave function psi of x. So this Schrodinger, time-independent Schrodinger equation is written down here. It is minus h bar squared by 2m d squared psi by dx squared, which I denote psi double prime, and then is equal to e times psi of x. So this is the time independent Schrodinger equation. We will come to the time dependent Schrodinger equation shortly. Now this equation we can rearrange a little bit and write psi double prime on the left is equal to minus 2m e by h bar squared psi of x. I just rearranged this equation. So I will denote the quantity on the right hand side by minus k square. Yeah, I will discuss about the sign and so on. So this k here is defined as the positive square root of 2me upon h bar squared. Yeah, so it's the positive square root. So k is only a positive number over here. That is, we are assuming that e is positive. Now, this is classically reasonable because in classical mechanics, the Hamiltonian is p squared by 2m. So the square of momentum is a positive quantity, and therefore the energy should be positive. This would be your expectation. This is correct also in quantum physics. Now, this equation is called an eigenvalue problem or eigenvalue equation. So the time-independent Schrodinger equation, I would like to view it as an eigenvalue problem. So it's an eigenvalue problem for the Hamiltonian operator H. The Hamiltonian operator is the second order differential operator minus h bar squared by 2m d squared by dx squared. So this is the Hamiltonian operator. So second order differential operator. And the right hand side is the eigenvalue. We will interpret that as the energy eigenvalue. So the time independent Schrodinger equation is simply the eigenvalue problem for the Hamiltonian operator. The corresponding eigenvector, psi of x, is called the wave function or eigenfunction of energy or of the Hamiltonian. So the wave function psi of x has some physical meaning, which we will discuss in more detail as we go. There are some subtleties involved in this, but to begin with, let me give you the basic interpretation. Yeah. So again, I say that you are welcome to interrupt me or ask for any clarifications, or in case the slide is moving fast or slow, something, you can definitely tell me. So psi of x is called the probability amplitude. So this is the important word, amplitude. Probability amplitude. It's not probability, it's a probability amplitude. In general, psi of x is a complex valued function. It is a complex function. Values are not necessarily real. It's complex, generally speaking. That is why we call it an amplitude. An amplitude is something that when you take the absolute square, you get the probability. Okay? So this is a big distinction between probability amplitude and probability. So according to Max Born, one of the early and important contributors to quantum mechanics, quantum theory, who was German and later on worked in the United Kingdom. According to Born's interpretation of the quantum mechanical wave function, the absolute square of psi squared times a dx. Now this is a real quantity because the absolute magnitude squared becomes real. So this quantity is a real quantity. It is interpreted as the probability for finding the particle between x and x plus dx. In other words, within dx of the location x. So that is the interpretation of this quantity. I emphasize again that psi of x can be complex, whereas the absolute square is real. We will come back to this interpretation and how to understand the free particle in terms of this concept. For now, let us proceed to understand the solution of the Schrodinger equation, time-independent Schrodinger equation. So if I go back and look at this equation psi double prime is equal to minus k squared psi has two linearly independent solutions. Yeah. Say second order differential equation, two linearly independent solutions, which you are familiar with, e to the power of ikx, one, and the other is e to the power of minus ikx. Both of these for k positive, e to the power of ikx and e to the power of minus ikx. If you prefer, we can work with e to the power of ikx plus e to the minus ikx by 2, which will be called cosine kx, or e to the power of ikx minus e to the minus ikx by 2i, which is sine kx. Right? So according to your preference, you can work with sines and cosines or exponentials. For the interpretation purposes, I prefer to work with exponentials. You will see why, because it has a definite interpretation in terms of momentum if we work in terms of exponentials. Whereas we work in terms of sines and cosines, the interpretation in terms of momentum is not so direct. For that reason, we will work with exponentials. So we have two linearly independent energy eigenstates. Yeah, this equation is very familiar to you. You have probably met it even in classical physics. For the harmonic oscillator, same equation arises. The interpretation is very different there, of course. can of course put this e to the power of ikx inside here and check that it is satisfied. So, but the key thing is that for each value of energy, for each value of E, which I have written here as h bar squared k squared by 2m, for each positive energy, we have two linearly independent solutions. So this is already the first non-trivial feature of the system. We say that every energy level, there are a lot of energy levels. In fact, a continuously infinite family of energy levels, yeah, starting from zero upwards, 0, 0.1, 0.145476, yes, all energies are allowed, zero and above. And all energies that are strictly greater than zero are doubly degenerate. This system has a two-fold degeneracy of energy levels. Yeah, just like in the harmonic oscillator, we find that energy levels are non-degenerate. At every level, energy, you have only one linearly independent eigenvalue, whereas here we have one linearly independent eigenfunction, but here we have two. Okay. So we say that the degeneracy of energy levels is two. Any questions so far?
No question.
Yeah. So, now you are
so, students, so whenever you have doubt, please clarify,
yes, sir.
Please interact.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Very good. Yeah. So, now let us make a few more remarks. See, my talk today is very limited in scope, but I want to make sure that what I do say, I convey as clearly as possible. Since I cannot see you directly, I don't know whether you are sleeping, whether you are what is happening. So I will go slow. I hope you had a good lunch, but not so good a lunch that you are feeling sleepy. Okay, so now let us look at the energies in a little bit more detail. The first observation is that the energy eigenvalue E must be greater than or equal to zero. Namely, negative energies are not allowed. Now let us try to clarify why this is the case. Yeah. Let us examine this differential equation once again, supposing that energy is negative. Suppose E was negative. This is again the same free particle time independent Schrodinger equation. Suppose E is negative. Yeah. That still allows us to solve this differential equation. In fact, we can write down solutions. E to the power of real exponentials. E to the power of plus kappa x and e to the power of minus kappa x. We have two possible linearly independent solutions, where kappa, I'm supposing that E is negative. Okay, so this minus sign and that minus sign will go away. Yeah. And I can define a kappa, which is the square root of minus 2me by h bar squared. So remember, E is negative. So this quantity under the square root is a positive quantity. So kappa is a real quantity. Yeah. Kappa is a positive real quantity, I assume. So then this equation admits two linearly independent solutions, e to the power plus or minus kappa x. Now, as you are familiar, this is either a growing exponential or a decaying exponential. Yeah, these are the two possible wave functions for negative energy. So as far as mathematics is concerned, these are fine solutions. However, if we now imagine that these wave functions represent the probability amplitude of finding a particle at the location x, then there is a little problem. Yeah, in these states that I just now derived, in these states, the particle has an ever-growing amplitude to be found at larger and larger values of x. Okay, so the probability to be found at x equal to 10 kilometers is large, x equal to 20 kilometers is even larger, and x equal to 100 kilometers is even larger. Now, this is physically unacceptable if we want to describe one particle. Yeah, because then the total probability to be found anywhere will be infinite. But even the probability to be found in some region, as that region goes further and further to the right, will grow unboundedly. So for these reasons, we would like to disallow the negative energies. Okay, for this reason, there are other reasons one can propose also, but this is a simple-minded way to see why we would like to disallow these negative energies. I will say more about these issues as we go along. Yeah. So basically, we are allowing only the e to the power of ikx, e to the minus ikx, sine kx, cosine kx type of solutions. Even they have problems, no doubt. They also are going to have some problems. We will discuss that. Yeah. But these real exponentials have even more severe problems. They are simply growing unboundedly. For that reason, we are disallowing them. Not to mention, even in the classical theory, negative energies are not there. The Hamiltonian is positive. Even in the quantum theory, yeah, there is a sense in which the Hamiltonian is a positive operator. That its eigenvalues are positive quantities. Now, let us then leave aside negative energies. There is one more case which I have to consider, namely the energy zero. Let us take a moment to understand the energy zero. That is also very interesting. It's a limiting case, the borderline between positive energies, where we said there are two independent solutions, e to the plus ikx, e to the minus ikx. Negative energies, where there are no acceptable solutions. At energy zero, there is actually an interesting solution. That is what we will call the ground state. The ground state is the minimum energy for any system. In this case, the ground state is energy zero. That is a limiting case. If you look at sine kx and put k equal to 0, then that goes away. It becomes the zero function. On the other hand, if you take cosine kx and put k equal to 0 or energy equal to 0, you get 1. Similarly, if you take e to the power of ikx or e to the power of minus ikx and put k equal to 0, in both cases, you will get the function 1. This function we will call as the ground state wave function. So the ground state, notice that e to the plus kx and e to the power of minus ikx, both of them give the same function, 1, when I put k equal to 0. So the two-fold degeneracy is gone. When energy becomes 0, the two-fold degeneracy is gone, and you have only one linearly independent wave function. Well, this has to be clarified. In the next point, I'll clarify it. But at least now, we have discovered one non-trivial solution for energy zero. That function is simply the function psi equal to 1. You put that function here, psi double prime will be 0. So energy zero satisfies this equation. So clearly, a constant function like psi equal to 1 is a legitimate solution of this equation. Yeah. Still, we have to interpret it physically. We will come to that. Well, if you are a little observant, you will notice that that is not the only possible solution. When E is 0, there is one more solution, right? Suppose E is 0, right hand side is 0, psi double prime then has to be 0. Then there is a two parameter family of solutions, namely AX plus B, psi equal to AX plus B. If you take the second derivative, B will go away. First derivative, you will get A, second derivative, that also goes away. So this is definitely a solution of that equation. Previously, what I talked about was the constant solution, which is basically consisting only of the B part. Yeah, up to normalization, only the B part I considered previously. But if we allow also for the A, then we get a linear function, linearly growing, linearly decreasing function. Now, this is again a two-parameter family of solutions. After all, it was a second-order differential equation. So two integration constants, two linearly independent solutions. Even for energy E equal to 0, there are two linearly independent solutions. However, we are going to again omit the solution with A. With A non-zero, get a linearly increasing wave function. So the square of the wave function will increase quadratically, like x squared, okay, like a parabola. So then it will say that the probability to be found farther and farther away, for particle to be found farther and farther away, grows quadratically with x. Again, that we will find is not suitable for describing a particle. And for this reason, we will disallow this AX type of solution. Okay. So summary so far.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir,
yes, okay.
Doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Actually, this is a general one.
The voice is not
loud. Sir, what is the indirect meaning in negative? So you would...
Yeah. So thank you for your question. I heard only some part of the question.
Can you explain about that?
Am I understanding correctly? You asked about negative energy solution.
Oh, is yes, that okay, sir. I will...
No, can you repeat the question? Yeah, you can go ahead and ask your question. That's fine. Yes, please ask. Yeah, okay. Well, I did not hear your question very clearly, but I only heard one word, which is negative energy. So I want to, okay, if that was your question, I will make a few comments. If it is something else, you please ask once again, or you put it in the chat. In case I am lucky, I will see, read the chat. You are perfectly audible.
Sir, now am I audible?
So please tell, yes.
Yes, sir. Actually, what's the indirect meaning of that negative energy? We usually use it to say negative energy, am I right? Actually, what's the meaning for that? Usually, negative energy cannot be negative. Am I right?
Okay. So this
they are indicating.
Yeah. Excellent question. So let me make a couple of remarks about this and dispel some confusions also. See, first of all, there is nothing wrong with negative energy. Let us recall what energy in classical physics. Energy arises through the potential, for example. Yeah. Now, you remember in classical physics that the force is given by the negative gradient of the potential. So if you add a constant to the potential energy, which will then shift the zero of energy. Suppose you subtract a constant from the potential energy, if you keep on subtracting some constant, it will not affect the force, right? Because the gradient of a constant is zero. So the force is unaffected by shifting the zero of energy. So there is nothing wrong in making the energy negative because it will not affect the forces between particles. So the first idea is that negative energies are not bad in themselves. Okay. Something more has to be said in order to deal with this. So then we have to tell precisely what is the zero of energy. That is a matter of convention. We have to pick a zero of energy. And according to that convention, from there onwards, we have to discuss. So suppose we choose a convention, like in my discussion, I have chosen a convention where the potential is exactly zero, the zero function. You may not like it. You may prefer a potential function, which is a -2 function. That is a completely legitimate potential. And in that case, the energy can go down all the way till -2. Nothing wrong with that. But then what I am saying, that the energy cannot go below -2, okay, or below zero in my convention. So the answer to your question is that the zero of energy is a matter of convention, at least in these areas of physics, in quantum mechanics and classical mechanics of normal systems. Yeah, there are some exceptions in gravitational physics, but we are not discussing that. Yeah. So negative energies are not bad. Let me give you one more example. In the hydrogen atom, in the usual convention, the potential is given by minus constant by R, minus constant by R. So the potential is actually negative everywhere. It's attractive potential, it's negative. We do not complain. Even in the Kepler problem, the potential is negative, minus GMM by R. Okay, we don't complain there also. What is it in the hydrogen atom, which is based on the Coulomb potential, attractive Coulomb potential? Most of the interesting states, in fact, all the bound states of the system have negative energies. Yeah, minus 13.6 electron volt divided by n squared, where n is 1, 2, 3, principal quantum number. So negative energies are not a bad thing. If you set up your convention properly, negative energies will simply refer to bound states, and positive energies will refer to scattering states. Yeah, I will tell more about bound and scattering states, but I want to, at this stage, just want to dispel the notion that negative energies are either strange or bad or to be avoided. It really depends on your system. It really depends on what the Hamiltonian is. If your Hamiltonian is positive, then a negative energy is a bad thing. It cannot occur. However, if your Hamiltonian itself has a negative potential, there is nothing wrong with negative energies. You can ask similar questions in another system, like a relativistic particle, etc. One has to discuss those issues in that context with the proper background. Maybe this is not the place to do it. Perhaps you have in mind the Dirac equation or Klein-Gordon equation and so on. Yeah, the main issue, to say it in a brief way, is not with negative energies. Negative energies are not bad. What is problematic is an energy that is unbounded below. Yeah, energies that can become arbitrarily negative are a problem, because that will mean that the system is unstable. If the energy of a system can become arbitrarily negative, yeah, then the system, through some interactions with external agents, could fall to lower and lower energy eigenstates, or classically go to lower and lower energies, and perhaps you could extract a lot of energy from the system. So that might be a little bit problematic. Negative energies in themselves are not a bad thing, but energies that can become arbitrarily negative are a bad thing. They signify or are symptoms of instabilities in your system. So if there is an instability, then deal with it. If there is no instability, then make sure the energy is not arbitrarily negative. Have I addressed some of your questions? Okay. Yeah, I am not able to hear you, but okay, I think I have said a few things about your question. Let us now proceed a little bit further. I just was talking about the free particle in quantum mechanics, and we have made the observation that for energy E equal to zero, energy eigenvalue E equal to zero, the ground state has only one linearly independent solution that we will accept, namely the constant wave function. The linearly growing wave function we are going to eliminate, because the probability will grow very rapidly as you go farther and farther. Okay, so we say that for the free particle, the ground state is non-degenerate, only one state. Excited states are all doubly degenerate. Yeah, so this is the first result we have obtained. Okay, now let me proceed a little further, and let us understand these energy eigenstates in a little bit more detail. The energy eigenstates I write as e to the power of plus or minus I kx, where k is a positive quantity. A I call a normalization constant, which we will talk about later on. It's not very important currently. Yeah, in fact, here also there's a little problem in interpretation. Even in the energy eigenstates A e to the plus or minus I kx, the position space probability distribution, right? Remember, Born has told us take the absolute square to get the probability distribution. In this case, that probability distribution is a constant, absolute square of A. So it's constant and uniformly spread all over position space. So if we take literally what Born has taught us, this particle in this energy eigenstate is equally likely to be found at all locations. Okay, so that is on face value, this is what we have found. There is some truth to it. In an energy eigenstate, e to the power of I kx or e to the power of minus I kx, the probability is uniformly distributed everywhere. The particle is equally likely to be found at all locations. As a consequence, if you take the integral of the absolute square of the wave function, you will get infinity. Okay, so we say that this energy eigenfunction is not square integrable. Yeah, its norm, L2 norm, is not finite. But we may be willing to live with that for the present. There may be some wall far away that we should not really integrate all the way to infinity, but maybe to the end of the lab or to the end of the city, yeah, or some region may be there within which the particle is confined, then one may be able to live with this kind of situation. So, but the main conclusion is, let us not put any wall. The main conclusion is that energy eigenstates do not represent position localized particles. Okay, they are delocalized, they are equally likely to be found anywhere. So energy eigenstates do not represent localized particles. This is our first physical observation. Now, having studied the time independent Schrodinger equation, I would like to proceed to the so-called time dependent Schrodinger equation, which tells you about dynamics. Okay, the word dynamics has to do with time evolution. Dynamics means how does a system evolve in time, starting from some initial state. Now, let us suppose the initial state is an energy eigenstate. That is, you start with an energy eigenstate like e to the power of ikx and ask how will the state evolve in time. The answer to that question is given by the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. So this equation, which I have highlighted, is the famous equation ih bar partial psi partial t is equal to h psi, where h is the Hamiltonian operator. Okay, so now this equation, let us try to solve, assuming that psi is an energy eigenstate. So if h is an psi is an energy eigenstate, it means that h psi is equal to e psi. Therefore, the right hand side we can already simplify, can replace h psi with e psi, where e is simply the energy eigenvalue. Then this partial differential equation in time, so first order partial differential equation in time, becomes d psi dt is equal to minus I e by h bar psi. Okay, basically I have taken the I h bar to the other side and replace h psi by e psi. Now this equation you can solve immediately by separation of variables. These are all constants. Yeah, so you can separate the variables. You can bring the time psi down below over here. And then you get d by dt of psi divided by psi, which is derivative of log psi, is equal to minus I e by h bar. So integrating once, you get that psi of x t is equal to psi of x comma 0 times e to the power of minus I e t by h bar. Okay. So this gives the time dependence of an energy eigenstate. Yeah, suppose the wave function is in an eigenstate of energy at t equal to 0, it will evolve forward in time in this manner. Sometimes we call this quantity E by H bar as omega. Okay? E by H bar is simply denoted omega. Now for a free particle, what we have discovered is that the time dependence of any free particle energy eigenstate with energy given by H bar k squared by 2m, that was the energy, is given in this very simple fashion. Both e to the power of I power minus I kx plus omega t. Right? Notice in both the terms you have e to the minus I omega t. E to the power of I minus I omega t is the time dependence. The spatial dependence is different. One is e to the power of I kx, other is e to the power of minus I kx. Okay. We are already reaching some very interesting features now. For those who have not studied it previously, we will say that this solution of the Schrodinger equation, time-dependent Schrodinger equation, is a linear combination of two traveling waves. These are traveling waves, namely a right moving wave, which will be this one, and a left moving wave, which is the other one, this one. This is the left moving wave. Okay, let us understand why I am calling it right and left moving. Okay. So now this is a very basic fact from wave mechanics, not having to do with quantum physics. It's just a general feature of waves in a string or in a sound wave or in liquids, etc. Suppose at t equal to 0, my wave amplitude is some f of x. at t equal to 0, suppose my the amplitude of my water wave is f of x, and suppose it is peaked at x equal to 0. F of x is my water wave at t equal to 0. And suppose we have a wave that depends on time in the manner f of x minus ct. Okay, that is the time dependence I am told, f of x minus ct. Now I ask the question, how does the wave profile look at another instant of time? Suppose we go to a new time t1, which is greater than 0. Then the new wave profile is given by f of x minus ct1. Okay, because the general profile I have said is f of x minus ct. Putting t equal to t1, I get f of x minus ct1. Now I ask, where is this new profile located? Recall that f of x was peaked at x0. Therefore, f of x minus ct1 will be peaked at the point where the argument of the function is equal to x0. Wherever this quantity is equal to x naught. Therefore, the peak of this new function is located at x equal to x naught plus ct1. Like that, if you go to later and later times, this traveling wave will be peaked at the location x naught plus ct2, x naught plus ct3, and so on. In other words, if c is positive, c is the speed, if c is positive, the wave is a wave of translation towards the right. Any function of the sort f of x minus ct represents a right moving wave traveling with speed c. I think you will agree with me that if c is negative, the same argument applies, but it is left moving instead of right moving. Okay, so this is a valuable observation. And I am summarizing that in this little diagram here. X is the horizontal axis, and we have the two solutions, e to the power of I kx minus omega t and e to the power of minus I kx plus omega t. You notice that this is of the form f of x minus ct, and that is of the form f of x plus ct, okay, where c is equal to omega by k. C here is omega by k. So this represents a right moving wave, and this represents a left moving wave. So I would like to once again take a moment and ask you whether you have any question about this feature.
Sir, how can C be negative, sir?
How can C be negative? See, C is simply by C here, I do not mean the speed of light. Okay, C is simply a variable that I have introduced. Let us ask which variable it is. From comparing this formula with this formula, C is simply omega by k. Now, if I go back to the solutions we obtained, there were two sorts, e to the power of I kx and e to the power of minus I kx. In other words, there are solutions with k positive and solutions with k negative. Only thing, I have kept the sign oppositely. So in both cases, I took k positive, but I am regarding omega by k as c, and c is just the speed. It is not the velocity. C is the velocity, okay? C is the velocity. And if it is positive, it means right moving. And if it's negative, it means left moving. That is all. Even in this diagram, if I had chosen C to be negative, the peak will shift to the right, left rather than to the right. Did I clarify to you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Sure. Any other question? So the picture that is emerging is that the free particle energy eigenstates are of two sorts, e to the power of ikx minus omega t and e to the power of minus ikx plus omega t. And we are interpreting them as right moving and left moving waves. Okay, and crucially, these waves preserve their shape. This exponential function remains exponential function. It does not become a Gaussian function or some hyperbolic cosine function or anything. It retains its shape as it travels rightward and leftward. Okay, so in fact, we can combine these two factors, e to the power of ikx minus omega t and e to the minus ikx plus omega t. We can combine the two and write a common wave function
Yeah, so let me just write that. I want to skip over the explanation. I think previously I said K is positive and there are two solutions. Now I want to combine them into one solution where K can be either positive or negative. So I will write the solution, the free particle energy eigenfunction along with time dependence in a very simple way as simply e to the power of I kx minus omega t, where K can be positive, it can be negative, it can be zero, all are allowed. Okay, I have combined the cases together. If K is positive, then it is a right moving wave. If K is negative, it's a left moving wave. And if K is zero, it is a non-moving wave. It is a stationary wave. It is not moving anywhere. K is equal to zero. That's the ground state. The ground state is not moving. So you can compare to the classical theory of a free particle. Classically, a free particle in its ground state is simply at rest at some location. Zero energy, zero momentum, zero velocity. Yeah. Whereas a free particle that has got some energy will be moving either rightwards or leftwards. Okay? These are the two possibilities. That is the reason for the degeneracy. Rightward movement with some velocity and leftward movement with the opposite velocity cost the same energy. That is why energy levels are doubly degenerate. Whereas if the energy is zero, there is only one way you can be, namely at rest. So that is why the degeneracy is one for the ground state. Yeah. Now these energy eigenstates are called by a nice name. They are called plane waves. Let us say why this is called a plane wave. This wave, this wave function is called a plane wave because notice that it is not dependent on y and z. It's a function only of x. Okay. So this function is constant on the yz plane. The vertical yz plane, this function is a constant. All right. So in other words, this wave function represents a function which is constant on each plane perpendicular to the x-axis. Generally speaking, the surfaces on which a wave is constant are called its wave fronts. Okay? What we have discovered is that the wave fronts of the free particle wave functions are planes. They are planes parallel to the yz plane. Okay, that is why we call them plane waves, because the wave fronts are planes. Moreover, these wave fronts or plane waves are propagating either to the right or to the left. This direction of propagation is given basically by the sign of k, and it is convenient to denote this k x hat, this vector, call it the wave vector. It gives the direction of propagation. If the wave vector is positive, is it directed rightwards, it is rightward propagation. If it's pointed leftward, it's leftward propagation. So plane waves have wave fronts which are planes orthogonal to the wave vector. Similarly, you have concept of spherical waves where the wave fronts are constant on spheres. Okay. That will be in an explosion or implosion. Yeah, if you have an explosion from a point, spherically symmetric explosion, the wave fronts will be spheres, concentric spheres that are radially going outwards. Okay. So we can now give a second interpretation of what we just said. In terms, sir, of, yes, please tell me.
Sir, can you tell me other reason for using plane wave?
Yeah. See, we are considering a one-dimensional problem here. Okay. One reason why plane waves are coming up here is that we are in one dimension. Only x we are paying attention to. And the propagation is along the x direction, and there is no dependence on the y and z directions. That is why this plane aspect is coming in. If we were doing the three-dimensional or two-dimensional problem, again, you will get plane waves as the solution. E to the power of I, k dot k1 x1 plus k2 x2 plus k3 x3, where x1, x2, x3 are xyz coordinates. Okay? Then you will say that k1, k2, k3 are the components of the wave vector, and e to the power of I k dot r is a plane wave which is constant on planes orthogonal to the wave vector k. So you have a wave vector k that could point in any direction, and the planes orthogonal to that are called the wave fronts. And again, the wave fronts are moving along the direction of the wave vector. So even in three dimension, you do get plane waves as energy eigenfunctions. However, you are not obliged to consider, in higher dimensions, you are not obliged to consider only plane waves. It is possible to take linear combination of plane waves to get other kind of waves. You can even get a spherical wave by taking linear combination of plane waves. Yeah, so especially in higher dimension, in three dimensions, there are many problems for which plane waves are not convenient. Plane waves may be convenient if you have a beam of particles coming in one direction, all right? But suppose it scatters against something and produces an outgoing wave, yeah, maybe to some approximation even spherically symmetric. Yeah, maybe there is a situation where angular momentum is conserved. Yeah, under so those circumstances, it is not so convenient to work with plane waves. Often one needs to work with spherical waves because you may have an explosion or implosion or scattering against a spherically symmetric potential. In those problems, one can take linear combination of plane waves to form angular momentum eigenstates, which are having more to do with spherical waves. So it depends on the context. In one dimension, it so happens there are no spherical waves. There is only one direction to move, and therefore you get plane waves. But in higher dimensions, there are other possibilities. Does that address your question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you for the very interesting question. Yes. So I wanted to give one more interpretation about this left moving and right moving in terms of another very basic physical quantity, namely momentum.
Sir? Now, remember,
yes, please.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Sir, yes. Sir, similarly, I have one question, sir. Why psi of x should be complex?
That's a very good question. Why psi of x should be complex?
Should be complex.
Right.
In initial.
Yeah.
Right. Yes, sir.
This is a very good question. And to be honest, there is no simple answer to this question. Yeah, we can offer various reasons. Let me take a moment to say a few remarks about this. See, according to Born's probability interpretation, it is only the absolute square of psi that is the probability. Okay. Now probabilities have to be real. Yeah, there are some numbers. The probability of getting something is half or two thirds and so on, or zero, one, and so on. Okay. So probabilities have to be real. Probabilities have to be real numbers. Now, if you take the absolute square of some quantity and get a real number, now it may be that that quantity is also real. The square of a real number is, of course, real, but it doesn't have to be. The absolute square of an imaginary number is also real. The absolute square of a complex number is also real. Okay? So the framework allows the wave function to be complex, okay? Because it is only the absolute square that gives you the probability interpretation. Okay? So now this is not an explanation. This is simply an observation that a complex valued wave function would not come in the way of interpreting the absolute square as a probability. Okay? So at least it is allowed. Now that is one aspect. Let us address some other aspects. Again, the honest answer to this question is that this question can only be answered by comparing the predictions of the theory with the experiment. Okay? There is no other clear answer to this question. Somebody makes a model of quantum mechanics. These are the equations, these are the objects, there's a complex valued wave function. You calculate results of experiments and check them. If you get the right answer, you believe the theory. If you get the wrong answer, you have to modify the theory or throw away the theory. Okay. So the honest answer to your question is that here we have a framework where wave functions are allowed to be complex. The results coming from that model, from that theory, seem to agree with experiment to our current precision, and therefore we believe it is true. That is the real answer. But there are additional circumstantial evidences why we need complex wave functions. Let me give one elementary observation. Let us go back and look at the Schrodinger equation. Yeah, the Schrodinger equation which I have highlighted here, yeah, I h bar d psi dt is equal to h psi. Now, h is some operator like, say, minus h bar squared by 2m d squared by dx squared. Now, suppose psi is a real function, right, like cosine x or something, then you notice that even if psi is initially a real function, when you operate h on psi, again, you will get some real function. After all, you are differentiating some function two times, again, you get some real function. However, the wave function at the next instant of time will become complex because there's an I sitting over here. So in other words, Schrodinger time evolution, will force even a real initial state to become a complex state at later instance of time. So restricting yourself to real wave functions will not be consistent with the Schrodinger equation. So so this is one more reason why we need complex. But again, I must tell you, this reason I have told you is a fraud. Okay, because you will say, why should I accept the Schrodinger equation? Yeah, some other equation, this Schrodinger equation is not the right equation. Why should there be an I over here? Okay, that's a very legitimate question. Why should I keep an I in the Schrodinger? Why not remove the I? The answer to all these questions is only the comparison of the results of the theory with experiment. Now, to read more about this, I would suggest the book by David Bohm, quantum theory, where he gives several reasons and studies the need for a complex valued wave function. I mean, I am not going to try to reproduce that in the few minutes here, but there is a nice discussion. This is an old book by David Bohm, a very nice book on quantum mechanics, where he gives several reasons. In fact, there are many, many attempts to reformulate quantum mechanics purely in terms of real wave functions without any I and such things. Okay? All those attempts have not succeeded. Yeah. When I say not succeeded, either they are simply some rewriting of the existing equations in real and imaginary parts, just banishing the I and simply keeping all real quantities, which is simply the same theory written in double notation, or there are truly new approaches where there is no complex wave function, no I, nothing. And all of those attempts have basically failed because they produce results that do not agree with experiment. That is the real reason. Why you need I here, why you need complex wave function? Simple reason, in order to make theory agree with experiment. Additional reasons are all details, two of which I have mentioned to you. But there are more such things. There are serious attempts to have real wave functions and non-complex valued probability amplitudes. And it's worth pondering over. How would you replace this equation with a different equation without any I? Will you make it a higher order equation? What will you do? All those attempts have not succeeded. Yeah, this is the simplest solution to the problems of experiment. Have I addressed some of your questions?
Yes.
Okay.
Hello?
Yes. Okay.
Sure.
Yes, please.
I have a question, which is a general one. Sir, sometimes we define wave function as a psi is equal to a e power I k x. And as per the, if a wave function should be, it has some condition to be allowed, right? Like it should be when we are at infinity, it should die out. The wave function should die out. If e power I k x, if x is equal to infinity, then it just goes like anything at infinity. So why are we using that? And in the case of
shall I address this question before you go to the next question?
Yes,
you asked a very good question. Why is it acceptable that the wave function does not go to zero at infinity? Answer is yes, it is acceptable. Depends what kind of system you want to describe. Okay, this is always the question. What kind of physics you want to describe? If you want to describe a bound state, that is a situation where a particle is confined and cannot be found far away, cannot be found at infinity, then the wave function has to decay. Okay, because that is the physics you are studying. However, that is not always the physics we are studying. In a free particle situation, the particle is free to move. So it can go away, away, away and go to infinity. There is nothing preventing it. So it will be perhaps not bad to allow the wave function to be non-zero at infinity. There is a more serious problem. In the energy eigenstate, we found that the wave function is constant everywhere. That is equally probable to be found everywhere. It is not at any one place. That is a more serious issue. It does not describe a localized particle. I am intending to talk more about localized particles, even for free particles, as we go further. Yeah, but the point is that what are those admissibility conditions that you want to impose on the wave function depends on the physics you want to describe. If you want to describe localized particles, indeed, the wave function should go to zero at infinity. If you want to describe bound states, indeed, you want to describe wave functions that go to zero at infinity. However, if you want to describe scattering states, this is called is an example of a scattering state. Yeah, the wave function that has this e to the power of ikx behavior, you rightly pointed out it doesn't go to zero at infinity, but it is not correct to say blowing up at infinity. It is simply oscillatory.
Okay.
Plus I sin kx. So it's simply oscillatory even whether at zero or two or four or infinity. Yeah. So,
okay.
So in other words, these are a different class of wave functions called scattering wave functions. They have useful physical interpretation. Yeah, you had another.
Okay, sir. So in the case of potential step, we take state region 1, region 2. That time also we write some normalization constant e power ikx plus e power minus ikx. Isn't it a bound state like region 1 and region 2?
No, that's not a bound state. See, if you have a step potential, see the step is there, but the step simply goes on till infinity. Now, if the energy of the particle is below the step, you can imagine the particle can come in from the left, scatter against the potential, get reflected perhaps, and then go back. So the particle can come in from minus infinity, hit the wall and go back to minus infinity. All right. So that is not a bound state. The particle can escape. The particle can both come in from infinity or minus infinity and escape to minus infinity. So such a system is not bound. A bound system is one like a harmonic oscillator potential, not a step. But a harmonic oscillator potential, which is a confining potential, where the potential goes to infinity as x goes to infinity. In such a potential, the particle is bound. Then the wave function should go to zero at infinity. So please keep this distinction in mind. It is for bound states that you want the wave function to go to zero at infinity.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes. Any other question?
Sir, does we get accurate solution by using this kind of equation, sir?
Say that again. Can you ask your question once again?
Sir, does we get accurate solution by using this kind of equation, sir, in experimentally?
A good question. Yeah. So, see, in experiments, we actually do the following. We throw in single particles or a beam of particles one by one. What we have described right now does not describe such a situation because here we are saying the particle is equally likely to be found everywhere. What we have described are the so-called energy eigenstates. They have particles with definite energy. They are not particles with definite location. These are particles with definite energy, with definite momentum, but not with definite location. So when you ask the question, does it describe physically or experimentally relevant quantities? The answer is, what physical experiment are you doing? If you are studying localized packets, then this is wrong. Okay, you cannot use plane waves to describe localized packets. So this is not useful. In the second half of my lecture, I am hoping to describe wave packets. All right. However, if you are very intent, I want to study even experimentally particles with definite momentum, with definite energy, then this is correct. There is nothing wrong with this. Yeah. So it depends what experiment you're doing. But I think what you have in mind is an experiment where you have localized particles coming in from some beam or from some source, then these wave functions will not be correct. However, these wave functions, because they form a complete set of wave functions for the Hilbert space, can be used to create the wave functions describing localized particles. So they are not useless. They are useful for that purpose also.
Okay, sir.
Hello, is there any other question? Sir, otherwise you can please proceed, sir.
The momentum operator is defined as minus ih bar d by dx. I hope you have encountered this before, minus ih bar d by dx. Now, the eigenvalue of the momentum operator by convention is denoted either P or more commonly it is denoted h bar k. Okay. So now let us look at the Now, I claim that these energy eigenstates that we discussed so far, namely e to the power of ikx, where k is a real number, are also momentum eigenstates. Let us check. Suppose I act the momentum operator on this e to the power of ikx. I differentiate with respect to x, I will get an ik down. Ik times minus I h bar becomes h bar k because I squared is minus 1. In other words, the function e to the power of ikx is an eigenfunction of momentum with eigenvalue h bar k. So we have made an important discovery that these plane waves, namely these energy eigenstates, are also momentum eigenstates. Furthermore, let us look at the value of the eigenvalue. The eigenvalue is h bar k. That is the momentum of this state. So if k is positive, which we described as a right moving wave, k is positive, momentum is also positive. If k is negative, which we talked of as left moving wave, then momentum eigenvalue is also negative. So we have this nice correspondence that states with positive momentum are right moving, states with negative momentum are left moving waves. Yeah. So this is what you will also classically expect. Particle is moving to the right, it has positive momentum. Okay. Now, why did this happen? It happened because the Hamiltonian H and the momentum operator are commuting observables. The commutator of H with P, which is P squared by 2m and P, is 0. Okay. P commutes with P, so this commutator is 0, and therefore the Hamiltonian and the momentum operators commute with each other. We say that they are simultaneously diagonalizable, they are simultaneous observables. In other words, both are diagonal in the same basis. What basis is that? That is the plane wave basis. So in the basis of e to the power of ikx, both the energy and the momentum take definite values. Both of them have common eigenfunctions. Those eigenfunctions are given by this family, e to the power of ikx, where k ranges over all real numbers. Okay. So we have now dealt with energy and momentum. Now, any questions so far?
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, please.
Sir, since in the right moving and left moving wave, we are dealing with momentum and energy, right, sir? If it keep on moving to like n space or like that, doesn't it dissipate energy? If it dissipate energy, its waveform will be disoriented, right? But in the beginning you said the like shape of the wave doesn't change at all, like if like this is my understanding. Right. So
okay, I'm afraid I missed your maybe I missed some part of your question, but from what I heard, you are asking if the particle has certain energy and momentum and it keeps on moving, will not this energy decrease because yeah, you are absolutely right. And this is the very, very important conundrum which took many, many centuries for people to understand. Yeah, it took the genius of Newton and Galileo to realize that one has to idealize. The situation come to rest. They don't additional force called friction. And if you ignore friction, then you can talk about a truly free particle in the absence of friction and absence of any other force. Yeah? That's why we call this a free particle. It is not acted upon in any harmonic force. No friction is acted upon by no force. So reality particles do collide with other particles, they hit walls, they lose energy to friction, to heating, to death. They are not considering all those issues in this very limited setup. It is because the energy is simply p squared by 2m. Yeah, the classical equation of motion does not have any damping term. Okay? If you just take this as the Hamiltonian and work out Hamilton's equations, you will get x double dot equal to 0, yeah, or p dot equal to 0. Force is zero, so p dot is simply zero. Whereas if there is some damping force, some frictional force, you will say x double dot is equal to minus gamma x dot, right? Some velocity dependent force will be there. We have not incorporated such a thing. That is the reason this particle can go forever. In fact, can go off all the way to infinity. Am I clarifying this matter to you?
Yeah, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Any other question so far?
Hello.
Yeah. Now, in the Dirac notation, the momentum eigenstate, which so far was some e to the power of ikx, will now be denoted by a ket k. This ket k state, it's a moment. So this k is a label. It labels the state. And from that label, you can extract the value either of the momentum eigenvalue or energy eigenvalue. Okay. The corresponding somebody, many people are having some audio problem.
Yes, yes. It seems that.
It is a problem? Okay. One second. Maybe I will let me try to.
You will also join again. Then.
Okay. 1 second. Let me. How to avoid this problem? Let me. Can you hear me better now, or still problem?
Yes, sir. It's okay.
Now it's okay. Better.
It's a little better.
Yes.
Maybe the problem is with me. Maybe the.
Now it's clear, sir.
It's clear?
Yes, it's clear. Okay. Yeah.
Now it's clear? Okay. One second. I will shut the windows. There is some construction going on. 1 second. Can you hear me clearly now? Sit.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I don't know whether it's because the bandwidth is limited or there is noise. I have switched on my camera. If again the problem comes, please tell me.
Yes.
Okay, so now I said that we will restate our results using the so-called Dirac notation. Yeah, ket k is called a momentum eigenstate. It's an eigenstate of momentum with eigenvalue h bar k. And since momentum and energy commute, it is also an energy eigenstate with energy eigenvalue, which we have found before is h bar squared k squared by 2m. Now, we want to relate this so-called ket vector k to the wave function which we have learnt about before. Now, I just tell you that the position space wave function in the state ket k is given by the inner product of ket k with the position basis state bra x. Okay, so one has to study this in more detail. And I just want to mention to you that the position space wave function psi k of x, k is a label, remember, psi k of x is the inner product of a momentum eigenstate with a position eigenstate. All right, this ket bra x is a position eigenstate, ket k is a momentum eigenstate. This inner product is e to the power of ikx. Okay. If we are willing to take that as a definition for now, as the position space wave function, then you will remember that if I reverse the order of this inner product, change it to kx, then you get a complex conjugate. So kx is the complex conjugate of xk and is given by e to the power of minus ikx. Okay, so this is a immediate consequence. Yeah, we will keep these two facts in mind, and we can now write the time dependence of an energy momentum eigenstate in the Dirac notation. That is, the momentum eigenstate with momentum k at time t is given by the momentum eigenstate at time zero times this exponential factor e to the power of minus I omega t, yeah, where omega is e by h bar. Okay, now you would have heard previously that energy eigenstates are also called stationary states. So this is a very nice term, stationary states. I want to take 1 minute to explain why it's called a stationary state. Okay, a state is called stationary because in some sense it is stationary. Yeah, in some sense it is static. Okay, that is the reason for the name stationary. Stationary is not exactly the same as static. See, there is a time dependence. There is an e to the power of minus I omega t. Okay, so there is some time dependence, so it's not absolutely static. So that's why we use the word stationary. But stationary means something is not changing. Question is, what is not changing? What is not changing in an energy eigenstate? The answer is that the expectation value of any observable A in an energy eigenstate is independent of time. Okay, so let me remind you once more. A state is called stationary. Energy eigenstates are called stationary because the values of all observables, the expectation value of any observable in an energy eigenstate is independent of time. Okay, so expectation value is the average value that you obtain when you make measurements of an observable. In other words, in energy eigenstates, what I am claiming is that the mean value, the average value obtained in the measurement of any observable doesn't change with time. Okay, so let us establish, take only 1 moment to establish why this is the case. So there is some sense in which energy eigenstates are stationary. The average or mean value of all observables don't change in energy eigenstates. Let us use this Dirac notation to establish this in a 1 minute calculation. That is, what do I mean by expectation value? Well, up to normalization constant, it is the inner product ket kt sandwich the operator A and then the bra vector kt. Okay, so this is the state. This is the observable whose expectation value you want. This is the state once again. Now let us see. In an energy eigenstate, ket kt evolves in a very simple way, namely simply through a phase. Okay, eigenstates are very special. Energy eigenstates are very special. They don't mix with each other. They evolve individually. That is, energy eigenstate k does not get mixed with some k prime as time evolves. It just gets multiplied by a phase, only a phase. Okay, so you have one phase here. For k, you get e to the power of minus I omega t. Now for bra k, you have to take the complex conjugate. So you get e to the plus I omega t. Now see, these are two phases. A is an operator, but these are simply some complex numbers, right? So I can move it around. The two phases cancel out and you get k a k. Namely, the diagonal matrix element of A at time t in an energy eigenstate is the same as that time zero. Okay, for this reason, the expectation value of the observable A does not change with time in an energy eigenstate. Okay, so this is one aspect of why we call it a stationary state. Now I come to, any question about this matter? Are you able to hear me clearly once again?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay, very good. So now I am coming more towards this question about the interpretation of this wave function a little bit more. Okay, so let us see, what have we learned so far? We have seen that energy and momentum eigenstates ket k are not localized in position. Yeah, this is a sad feature. They are not localized in position. Namely, if I take psi k of x, take its absolute square. Okay, absolute square. That in our newfangled Dirac notation is ket k bra x absolute square. But that is simply e to the power of I k x absolute square equal to 1. Okay, so that is the reason the wave function is absolute square of wave function is constant. It's not localized. In other words, a system in a momentum eigenstate is equally likely to be at all locations. Okay, this is what the theory is telling us. We have to accept this is the prediction from the theory. Particle in a momentum eigenstate is equally likely to be found at all locations. Let us now compare this prediction of the theory with the Heisenberg uncertainty principle inequality. Okay, now the Heisenberg principle tells you that the uncertainty or fluctuations in x times the fluctuations in p in a state, any state, must be bounded below greater than or equal to h bar by 2. Okay, so this is the Heisenberg inequality. You would have all noticed it before in your studies. Now, if you are in a momentum eigenstate, it means that the momentum value is known to 100% accuracy. If you are in a momentum eigenstate ket k, you know that if you measure momentum, you will get only one value, namely h bar k. Yeah. Therefore, in a momentum eigenstate, delta p is simply zero. There is no fluctuation in momentum. There is no uncertainty in momentum. Momentum is precisely known in a momentum eigenstate. Now, if we believe that the Heisenberg uncertainty inequality has to be satisfied, where delta p is zero, now if delta x is any finite number, then that finite number times zero will be zero, and this inequality will be violated. Okay. So I am just giving a qualitative understanding here. The only way we can respect this inequality is if delta x is infinity. Carefully using wave packets, but momentum is precisely known, then their knowledge of position has to become lesser and lesser precise. And if the momentum is exactly known, the position has to be no knowledge thereof. Yeah, absolutely no knowledge of position, which means all positions are equally likely, all locations are equally probable in a momentum eigenstate. Okay, so this explains why it is not an inconsistency to have a wave function that is whose absolute square is a constant. Yeah, any comments about this matter? Any questions,
sir?
Yes,
hello.
Yes, please ask your question. Yes,
can we give some break of about 15 minutes so that
sure, whatever you would like. Yes, you can tell me anything.
Okay, what happens, students, shall we have some break or will we continue? So we will give some breaks actually.
Sure,
so, yeah,
we will have some break and then continue, sir.
Oh yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay. For what duration?
Break. Okay, then. Yeah, we can have some break, sir.
Yeah, please tell me at what time we will restart.
4:50. Is it okay, sir? 4:50.
4:50. Okay. That's okay, a good sir. Idea. Yes.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So we will meet once again at 4:50. Yes.
Yes, sir. Okay. We'll rejoin in 4:50, sir.
Yes. In 15 minutes, yes.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So students, please rejoin at 4:50. Just 15 minutes, have some break and come back.
Yeah.
Sir, professor. Yes. Yeah. Amal, sir, actually we can rejoin at about 4:50, sir. Yeah.